Shahnaz Basrai is he's a teddy bear from a different dimension. I don't know how he landed on Earth, but he's spent pretty much his entire life trying to figure out why it's so different from what he expects life to look like. So as a result, we have to suffer his various eccentricities and all these bizarre things, ideas that he comes up with. God, save us.
Once, when I was a small baby, I was sleeping and my daddy woke me up, and then daddy challenged mama that there was no poo-poo gonna come out on his finger, and when he put it in, all his whole pointer finger got filled with poo-poo. The end.
The question is Ayaz in one line. Ayaz is a guy with a genuine curiosity and optimism about life. He's genuinely also a pain in my ass.
Ayaz, ye sab to theek hai, but what was the client brief? Please explain.
Once, my daddy wanted to be cool in the sea. So, he got some new sunglasses. And then Mama told him not to go into the sea with the sunglasses, but he went with him carrying Mama. So then he went into the sea, and then a huge wave came and slapped him and took away his new sunglasses. The end.
Hi, Ayaz for me, he's a dynamic thinker with madness. He can make everything out of anything. That's the kind of person he is. Thanks.
Once my daddy was carrying me out of the house, and then he was discovering how to get a new belt. And that very moment, his pants fell off. And Mama couldn't help him because she was busy laughing. And daddy was too shocked. The end.
Oh man. MGD in with the production value, man. That's amazing.
Well, it's like current to our show, man. Wrong thing to say these days.
Oh, thanks, guys. Thank you very much, man. That's
just
amazing.
Just a quick one. This the whole effort for this was by Anuj. He got this coordinated. And the star you can see from your house. So big shout out to Anuj. Well done.
Wow. Thank you guys, man. This is amazing.
So we're going to start, Ayaz, with some questions for you. And before you share your work, just to get to know you a little bit more. So as a kid, Ayaz, were you a naughty kid? How were you in school? Did you get into trouble for stuff? This whole thing of Kida, right? So where was that implanted? How were you in school? Did you get thrown out of class? Where did that restlessness come from? Tell us a little bit about your school days.
No, so school was fairly, I didn't get into trouble. It used to be more behind the scenes trouble kind of thing. Like, set up like a situation where someone else will get badly fucked. But I think this Kida angle actually comes from my dad and my granny. Like, I think they were constantly at each other the entire, like, so basically she used to, there was one time in the morning between 7 and 8 o'clock when all of us used to avoid my dad because he was getting all these phone calls and, you know, it's like one of those planning the whole day. This is before mobile phones. So we used to all avoid him for that 1 hour because we knew he had to plan his whole day in that 1 hour. But my granny would every 5 minutes go out, ring the bell, and he used to open the door expecting some contractor or someone to come in and it would be her. You know, so this was like a daily thing. It was not even like a monthly or a weekly thing. So they were constantly, then he used to open her nada when she was climbing up the stairs in the building. And she couldn't walk properly. She had knee problems. So he would open her ghagra nada and then walk on. She was like, you know, juggling with her elbows, trying to climb up the stairs while keeping her ghagra on. Like, so I think some of it comes from there, I think, that this, constantly, doing ungli and messing around.
So it's genetically coded. Most just probably. A quick one about NID itself.
I've also had some great mentors, like, you know, Shwetab, I mean.
Yeah, so coming to Shwetab, one of your, Anuj. I know he's got some famous pictures of your modeling career in a see-through raincoat.
that Bhavani man. He's like a disgusting fellow.
Tell me a little bit about your NID stories. I'm just going to share one or two before you share them about what NID taught you or, you know, your influence from NID. You guys should hear Ayaz's version of, he's the only guy who Manu Gajjar has slapped. Manu Bhai is really come running in slow motion, jumped up and, you know, like a basketball dunk shot, giving him a slap.
Hey, you should unmute Abhimanyu. I mean, he'll tell this story. He was sitting right next to me.
Yeah, so the other thing was, Ayaz was, during the Star Wars days, he's a full craze on that. When it came out, there was this film playing in Rajshri. Ayaz painted his face as Darth Maul, put a whole white bed sheet, put a tube light. He sat in a bus because he didn't have a bike then, and all the gurus laughing at him. He went all the way to Rajshri and the film was only next week. So that's Ayaz for you. Ayaz, you want to just tell us a little bit about NID and how that shaped your thinking, or what do you look back and what do you remember?
No, NID was incredible. I mean, I also stumbled into it. I didn't know about NID till I was in 11th standard in college. And we happened to go to Ahmedabad on this trip to live in someone's granny's house, which was like, you know, the most bizarre kind of coincidence. And this granny happened to be the Lal Bhai, one of the Lal Bhais. So we were staying in this beautiful house and, you know, really, really nice, like peacocks walking around. And then we were like, you know, auntie, your house is beautiful. She's like, you know, want to see something better? You go to NID. So we landed up in the vacation. And I was with this other friend, Akarsh, who I know for a very long time. And, he's like singularly the most bizarre person I know. So we were not even in NID. We went and ragged some people who were sitting at the gate. Because they're like, hey, jaldi de gate khol ye wo, like, you know, it was very like strange kind of first introduction. But then I remember walking into NID and seeing the product design showcase, and there I realized, like, man, this is the place for me. Like, I have to get in here anyhow, because every single thing I was interested in, graphic novels, illustration, ye wo, which you don't really know that there's one place that can give all of that to you. Like, I realized that standing in front of that showcase. So uske baad it was like a very single-minded focus about just somehow getting in. And I remember actually messing around a lot in the entrance exam. That was because I was in this really, you know, overperforming group. Like, there was Anu Mishra and there were people who, you know, like already designers from like fourth standard types. And we had to do this clay model, which was like, they given us a little bit of clay and they said you make something with the maximum volume. And I looked around and everyone was making like spheres, you know, because like pi r cube and all that. And then I was trying to flatten my clay and I was banging it so hard that it went into that koya mat. So like half my clay went in that only. I was khurodoing it and trying to take it out to make something. And I had like this much clay left. So then I made a small speaker system with a volume knob. Because that was like the only thing that was left to do.
Maximum volume, good one.
So it's actually Fattas probably that, you know, that
got you to NID.
Yeah, it was definitely not skill.
And what about the whole experience on campus itself? Your whole design process, course, people like Ranjan, how did they shape who you are?
Yeah, no, Ranjan was definitely a father figure, man. He was my kind of faculty advisor, so I used to land up at his house like almost every week. I didn't have a really great time with faculty. I think Manu Gajjar slapping me was like the icing on the cake, but I had a problem with, like, I mean, I think most of the relationships were with very few people. They weren't like across the board. I think just the after class learning, like, I think I jumped into lots of other stuff. Like, I used to run LaserEgg for 3 years. Then we were, part of the SAC, part of Monsoon Fiesta. I was in the cheerleading section because obviously no sports skills. All of that, I think the whole experience of just being part of this really amazing community, every single room has some crazy inspiration going on. I remember before I joined, I walked into Shashank's room by mistake and he was doing some crazy big like Guns N' Roses illustrations. I was like, this is insane. Like, every single room you'd go into, like Bhupesh was on some other tangent talking about like Star Wars and Batula was there, who used to like, you know, spread out like 50 sheets and then ask us to select which one was the most refined. And so there was just so much inspiration around, so much inspiration. I mean, everyone here who's on this chat is like, responsible for in some ways to, shape everyone else's trajectory. So, I mean, so it's been an amazing experience to be part of, for sure.
Sure. So, the other thing is, when you came to Dubai and work, want to understand how that experience was. So, just a quick story before you go there. We had gone for this radio network launch, and there was a full crowd. I also got bored, and you go down to the beach and started doing belly dance. And that full party turned around and they're watching Ayaz. And we all acted like we didn't know him. We went for the meeting a few days later, and this client says, "I've seen you somewhere before." I said, "No, no, you don't know us." I said, "Hey, you're the belly dancer." I'm God, we do. That's what Ayaz came to Dubai and did. But how was that stint before you started your work? What is the kind of things you took away from Dubai experience?
Sajid, so my single-minded think of coming to Dubai was to work with you, because I mean, you actually, I don't know if you know, but you gave me my first job. It was I think 15,000 rupees. Me and Shekhar had designed a medical apparatus for Core, the parental.
Shekhar is on the call.
Yeah, Shekhar, he'll remember. This is the first check that we ever got, right? So in that sense, I felt like there's a huge amount of learning in terms of entrepreneurship, in terms of, you know, the nuts and bolts of setting up an office from scratch. And I was very, very clear that I wanted to join a, you know, like a startup with friends. I mean, you just came along at the right time, man. It was like really, really incredible, because I think that journey has, you know, massively shaped everything I've done after. Like, you know, so including, you know, having a great relationship with you since then and before. You know, so I can always reach out to you for, you know, any kind of advice, mentorship. I mean, it's so it was a fantastic ride. I think being part of a startup studio where you do everything, you know, like, I mean, I remember like there was this one thing where I had to go to Madagascar and, you know, Tunisia to set up some showrooms, like, you know, so it's like you're doing things for the first time. And the fact that, you know, the company behind you is backing you to be able to make all these mistakes or, you know, express yourself in whatever way possible. So, you know, I mean, it was, so I think it was the perfect first job. It was the perfect first thing. And I never felt like I needed more experience after, you know, 3 years at IdeaSpice.
So, and how did you go about setting up the company? What was the philosophy you set off with? Did you have something in your head? So, no, and what is the first project you got? How did the bus ride happen?
So I think when I, in the last few months of IdeaSpice, I kind of figured that I really, really want to work with space, you know, so the idea of, you know, creating space. And then that's what connected me with my brother and dad, who are both architects. Before that, there was no actual connection with working with them. And once I realized that space is something that's really exciting, I also realized I don't have the tools or the don't have the, you know, knowledge to be able to actually build something confidently. So, and I realized that in my dad itself, you know, he's got 40 years of built experience. Like, I felt like one of the main reasons to go back was to actually intern and work under him to really learn the ropes, you know. So, I kind of, when I moved back to Bombay, the thing was to move and work with him. So, for the first year, we just, I just did all his design work, you know, whatever it was, like tables, chairs, furniture, wall ceiling, whatever he needed to get done. And this was around the time that my brother Zamir was finishing his master's in Boston. So, we were very, very apprehensive about working together, because it's always complicated with family, right? I mean, small things can go wrong, and we're a very close-knit family. So we were, you know, even more apprehensive about something financially going wrong and stuff like that. So, but then, in fact, Shekhar, who's also here, I mean, we worked on a project with him freelance when he was working on the MIT ID campus in Pune. So yeah, So me and Zamir plugged into that project. Zamir was doing the architecture. I was writing the manifesto for education and stuff like that with Shekhar. And that project, actually, we worked together for the first time very closely, and we realized how much value we add to each other's, you know, thought process. He comes from a very, very different school of thought. But the discussions always are constructive friction. Like, you never feel that like some meetings that you get in, you feel you've come out with less than you walked in with, right? But in his case, like, it always felt like, you know, 2 + 2 becomes 20 somehow. So, so we realized we're sitting on something special, and that's when we formalized, the bus ride. I have to thank Bose, actually. Bose's name. No, he used to call me bus ride in ragging. Like, "Hey, bus ride, come here." And then we realized, like, you know, an unholy beginning is as good as any other. So,
yeah. Bose also named when, Dhiraj and Naranshi started, he called it Scripties. Their production company. So Bose has been part of a lot of interesting names. As what is the design process you guys follow? Like, you consistently, you guys get the work really good, because I think many of us designers don't know how to convince clients. A lot of things you push the boundaries on. So is there something you do differently in terms of your thinking? Because you're always restless, you're trying to do new things, and you also seem to be getting a buy-in from your clients. So what is it that you do? What is it that is different?
I think so. One of the key things we've always done, Sajit, is to constantly think about process, right? Like, so there's no, it's never like a situation where a process has been cracked and that will work for the next project. So we're trying to actually work with process first as much as possible. Like, what could be an interesting process to follow? And then the end outcome defines itself on its own. You know, so sometimes we've taken clues from writing stories for projects. Like, you know, so sometimes when you just write a hypothetical story about a project and that story becomes an idea generator. Sometimes we've taken bad jokes and made projects out of it. Like there was this one social we worked on in Bombay. It's in the building. The name of the building is called the Capitol in BKC. And it's, you know, got Standard Chartered offices and all of that inside it. And we created something called the Capitol Social, which is in that building. But the whole design is communist. You know, so it's designed by, like, it looks like a Russian bunker in the middle of, you know, the Capitol building. So it just forces you to think about capitalism differently, sitting in the middle of a business district in Bombay, right? So so one can actually pull it out of any kind of provocation. It's just a matter of, I guess, thinking that in some cases, like heritage conservation requires a very, very right-brained approach. So what we do is we use actually IAM management systems. Like, we create interaction matrices. You know, so okay. You're mapping X and Y correlation, positive correlation, negative correlation, which is actually a management practice, but applied to heritage conservation, because it's a good fit, you know, because you're trying to, you will decide based on a dispassionate decision. And just getting dispassionism, like getting a dispassionate output within a field like heritage conservation itself is innovation.
Sure.
So, I mean, I think we keep mixing it up, you know, and maybe I can talk a little bit about that in the presentation, like about how...
You get to your work and you can share the process as you go along. So one last question before you share your screen is, if you can explain this, I mean, I think your greatest project to date, if you can share the design process of the prank call you did on Aditi.
Oh yeah, man, that was very good. That was very good. Is Aditi here or what? No.
He's supposed to be here, so we can say before she comes.
So yeah, that was very good. It was a very elaborate setup also. So basically she messaged me once at 3:30 in the morning when I was in Delhi. And she was like, hey, you know, hi, good morning, whatever. It was a very strange message. Like, normally if you send someone a message at 3:30, it'll be like, you know, oh, I heard something. Are you okay or whatever? It was like a very like, hey, what's up? How are you? It was like an 8:30 in the morning message sent at 3:30 in the morning. So I was like, hey, kuch toh karna chahiye iske saath, right? So then I just checked quickly which countries are around 5 hours back from India. And Ethiopia happened to be one of them, right? So I wrote to her saying, hey, I'm in Ethiopia. It's like early in the morning. And how are you doing? Whatever. So she's like, oh, amazing. What are you doing in Ethiopia? So it started like that. It just started as a very random thing. And then over the next 3 weeks, I built up a very strong case that I'm in Ethiopia, right? So I sent her, like a whole bunch of pictures, you know, about like, there was some guy, some like, you know, small black kid holding like Hajar Dalda ka dabba and walking on the street. I sent a look at this. I saw this outside my, you know, outside the shoe. And she was like slowly buying into it, right? And then I also involved Kritika in this whole loop. So, like, you know, because I knew they were planning some travel somewhere. And then they got talking, say, look at Basra, he's traveling all over the place. We should also do something. So over 3 weeks, it became very clear that Ayaz is in Ethiopia, right? And then, so this is a bit parental guidance kind of situation. But like, I asked Riaz, who's one of our clients, to call her very early in the morning and say Ayaz has been busted for some, you know, some shady
organic stuff,
organic kind of dealing. So, and he's in jail and we need you to go to the Ethiopian embassy, you know, first thing in the morning to inquire about extradition procedures. So she obviously didn't believe it. And then I know Aditi for a while, right? So I figured who are the 4 or 5 people she's going to call. So there was Ayyar, Sumant, Nasir, Manish, and Hema, I think. So I kind of called them before and told them that, okay, she's going to call you. Just say you don't know where I am and you haven't heard from me. So like clockwork, she called all those people and they all said like, you know, I don't know, I haven't heard from him, whatever. And I think his parents are also looking for him. So then Aditi Dhar went in the morning to the Ethiopian embassy to inquire about extradition. And I mean, I don't know what happened there, but it seems like she told me later that she got really grilled because they were asking, what is her relationship with me? Like, you know, so then she had to lie and say, she's my fiance. And they're saying, what is his passport number? She's like, I don't know. So she obviously went very unprepared also to the Ethiopian embassy to inquire, like, you know, without figuring out kaun hai, kyun hai, kya. She's saying, in what jail is he? She had no idea. So it was, you know, and then she didn't talk to me after that for almost 2.5 months. Manish was the weak link, actually. Manish was the one who, you know, caved in. We could have pushed it for another week.